I want to remind you that this is Richard Dean Anderson.
A little busy, yeah. Oh, about 2,000 of my closest friends. I'm kidding. It's a countdown. It's a plot twist. Just take the picture. Okay, start the clock over again. I've been kicking around. Welcome to Salt Lake City. Thank you. So far, I haven't met a person I don't like in Salt Lake City. Come on! I swear to you, to a man, woman, and child, you've all been... I've done a few of these things, cons. And so far, I know. Some of them can be pretty rancid. If you've traveled around, some of you may know. But this one is, from my perspective and watching what you guys have had to deal with or get to deal with, it seems to be pretty smooth. Am I right? Wrong?
It's the greatest convention in the world, according to Stan Lee.
And he does not say that to everybody.
Yeah, he does.
Okay, what do you guys want to do?
They want to ask you questions, right?
And talk. Yeah, let's just get down to that, right?
Yeah.
Hi. Richard, as a dentist, my patients always try to fix their own teeth and they say, oh, I MacGyvered it. How do you feel about people using your character as verb? MacGyvering things.
Wait, let me understand this. You have a dentist or you're a dentist?
I am a dentist.
And you MacGyver things?
No, my patients try to fix their own teeth. I'm like, what did you do? And they say, I MacGyvered it.
MacGyver something in their teeth?
Yes, they try to fix it.
Oh my God.
I know. Thank you.
Oh, God, that's sick. Set them straight, Doc.
Thank you.
How does it make you feel, though, to have your character part of the lexicon? To MacGyver something?
It's kind of cool. No, actually what happened, initially was that our producer and somebody from Paramount that we were working for at the time approached Webster's Collegiate Dictionary and to submit MacGyver or MacGyverisms as an adjective, I guess that would be. No, that would be a... Well, to MacGyverize, yeah, but MacGyverism is a noun, right?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Awesome.
So proud. Anyway, we submitted the MacGyver French thing to Webster's, and they, because every 10 years they, and it's less now, I guess it's every 5 or 3 years, because they're so, you kids are making up so many words. Us older kids can't keep up. But anyway, we were 2 weeks late. And it didn't make the first round of dictionaries. I understand it's in there now. Is it? They owe me money. Is it, can I get something for you? Does she want something? Oh! Not hungry? Mother.
Please, go ahead.
Okay, yeah, sorry.
Hello. I was wondering if you could guest star in any TV show, past or present, what would it be?
Good. Oh. Should have submitted that so I could think about it. TV movies, and Doctor Who is in full swing, and we shared the same casting office, so that's as much as I know about Mr. Doctor Who. But it seems to be popular. They keep killing off lead actors, though, right? I can't keep up.
It must be a show you like.
TV or film?
Yeah, film!
Film?
Yeah!
Something animated.
Yeah!
I'm a big animation fan. Gosh, you can sit up in your underwear and do that. Who said yeah? I'm 67 years old. I've got roles, kid. It's not a pretty sight. Yeah. You got me curious now. Changed them last week.
I know.
You know what? Throughout the evening, I'll think about the show that I'd like to be on. But let's move on now.
Yes.
Lady.
What is your favorite TV show to play in?
Ooh.
You know? Yep. Is that the same question, or no?
No, I think she means all the shows that you've been in. What's your favorite?
Oh, is that what you mean? Well, many of you will not be familiar with Legend. Yeah, slight portion of the room. We did 12 episodes of a thing called Legend, where I had so much fun playing this character that was, yeah, it was a period Western, and got to play this nuts character who drank and smoked cigars and womanized and wore striped underwear. But it was so much fun to play, that big mustache, and got to roll around in the dirt. It was just a great departure from anything else I had done. You haven't seen it, have you? No.
Was that with John Delancey?
Yes, it was. But that was my favorite one. One that you would know? Probably. However, Stargate was so much fun.
Yeah!
Stargate was so much fun because, in part, because I had someone to talk to. I got lonely doing MacGyver after a while. But Stargate had great people to work with, phenomenal crew, and the cast members that I worked with primarily were just, I mean, we're all friends. We don't hang out. You know, I wouldn't want to go that far. So I keep my distance. No, they're all great people. And we had them all. So, okay. Of course, there was General Hospital. I was scared to death doing General Hospital. I had no idea what I was doing.
Please.
Yes, The Simpsons is my favorite show.
I'd like to know if any of the fabulous props that you've been able to work with ever came home with you.
Oh my God. That's a good one.
One. And she was... I guess a puppy wouldn't count as a prop, right? Co-star.
Nope.
No, we had a dog during MacGyver who... No, it was during the other one. Thank you. Stay close. And if you count that as a prop, that was my favorite ones. I took it home for like a night. But
oh, man.
Because I was at work all the time. I couldn't take care of the dog that I took from work. So I just brought it back to work and I kept him there. Thank you. Please.
Mr. Anderson.
Yes, sir.
I'd like to thank you for the enjoyment you brought us all throughout the years. And I have a very interesting... I was a substitute teacher for a year and a half and I created what is called the MacGyver IQ. How do you feel about that?
About what?
What can you do with what you know?
Well, I like the idea. The concept is great. Thank God I had great writers. Because I don't think I could, real life or fantasy. This is... Thank you. I think it's a great idea. I mean, you teach this? Microphone. He can still talk. He's...
As a substitute teacher, I wanted the kids not just to go for the grade. I wanted them to go for the information so that they could apply what they were learning, not just simply get the grade. The MacGyver IQ. What can you love about that?
My dad was a teacher, and he was a big proponent back in the 50s and 60s and 70s. And he was a big proponent of digging deeper or going further than you have to go. Whether you got questions wrong on a test or close but not quite, as long as you went at least that far and tried to extend the thought within a question or an entire test. Getting a little esoteric here, but it's, I love the concept. God bless you. Keep it up. Thank you. Yes, dear.
Yes, this is going to sound like a really random question, but it's for my boyfriend. Did you have an idea of any of an awareness of how big of MacGyver was in Bangladesh? Apparently, you have a huge fan base over there, and you're his childhood hero. So.
I was just talking about that with someone, like within the last 20 minutes. As they asked if I was popular in Sri Lanka, and I said, well, yeah, as a matter of fact, like, no, it was Bangladesh. And so it came to me like a whirlwind. Like, it's a rare occurrence when I can remember that far back. But yeah, I did know that, actually. In fact, I tried desperately at some point to go there and never was able. It was it's actually on a bucket list for them. That man, Antarctica.
He would have came, but he broke his leg, and so I'm up here instead.
Okay, well, watch your legs. Great socks.
You like it?
How does that feel to be recognized all over the world? I mean, is that kind of eerie or strange to you that people will come up anywhere and say, hey, you're MacGyver, you're Jack O'Neill?
Well, I don't have to be reminded of that, but I guess it's okay because, well, what's happened, the hot years have cooled a bit, so it's like I can go through life now and there'll be a double take here or there, or someone, what I really appreciate about the celebrity aspect of all this is the fans that have followed me and who dig deeper to find out what I'm like, what I like. Hell, I don't even know what that is. But everyone has been, as long as people are polite, I'll give you, you know, all the time you need. But that's been my experience, is that everybody kind of who's gotten to know me, done research or observed, they respect my space for the most part, except for one of you. But I mean, I'm not that conscious or conscientious about my, well, I should be more conscientious about my behavior because that element of celebrity is there, and apparently the celebrity type is held to a slightly higher standard morally. Physically, certainly, you know, a facelift I've had. Wait, there should be more laughter there because it's quite off. If this is a facelift, then boy, did I get gypped. But, what was the question? Here, you ask one.
I was wondering if you could take anything from the Stargate universe, whether it be the Stargate weapons, ships, or even Atlantis, what would you choose and why?
Oh, my.
Oh, God, I'd take the Stargate. Put it up in my backyard, invite the neighbors. Some of them I wouldn't tell how to get back. Common sense. Hi. You want to talk? So I went through at least a gross. You know how many that is? Guess.
40.
144. Yeah, great! At least 144, because my prop master told me that one. He also gave me a box of assorted, because we had different sizes depending on what kind of shot we needed. We cheat like that. But they don't stick very well. And I break them.
Please.
How you doing? My name is Phil. Big fan. I was wondering, are you going to be part of the reboot Stargate?
Oh, origin.
The what now?
Christopher said that there's possibly a reboot of Stargate. I was wondering if you're going to be part of it.
You know, you're going to have to ask Chris about that, because I hear that. I, you know, and
the web
boy, I hear it again, like coming here. but I haven't heard anything. I honestly don't know. I apparently, if anybody does know, it's you?
Yes, I do.
Tony,
I talked with Dean Devlin just a little bit ago. I think they were toying with the idea of Stargate Origins, which is the story of Catherine, the person that, whose father found the Stargate. But I don't know if that's going to, you know, include everybody. Because you guys time travel too, so.
Well, doesn't include me.
I don't know.
Nobody's even approached.
Did you check your mail?
I don't know how. But
you may have already gotten the part.
Yeah, we may be done shooting for all I know.
Please.
So my name is Jake, and the question I'm asking, so there's a new TV series, this is MacGyver, and I'm wanting to know if you've seen it or heard of it.
Oh, I've heard of it. I don't know if you all heard it, but he's asking about the new MacGyver.
It sucks!
What?
Good response over there, I think. That was me. Good question, serious question, serious answer. I don't like it. But for a reason. There's, you know, ego aside, all that, you know, well, why not me? That kind of stuff. That's over. Believe me. But in watching some of the episodes, it's not a MacGyver. It's not. It's just
technological.
I've become fond of describing it as a cop show with an iconic title.
Wow.
And because his partner's shooting everybody and killing everybody, and there's like, it's just all happens way too fast, and it's like you're asked to believe, or you're asked to fill in a lot of the blanks.
Oh, wow.
Whereas what we did was we showed you those blanks, those steps along the way to solve the problem. They're just going right to, you know, he picks up a bunch of toothpicks or whatever, and all of a sudden he's got a hula skirt. It's that association, I have no idea. But you know what I mean, you don't see the process. And we prided ourselves on, this is why it was such a not a pain, it was a joy, but it was really complicated to shoot MacGyver, because we had a new concept of a TV hero who didn't use a gun to solve that problem. We saw him see the problem, see elements of the solution, see him collecting it, putting it together, and then you see him, you know, weaving whatever toy he needed to solve that problem. You don't see any of that on the new MacGyver. Like I said, it's an, I guess, action-adventure cop show, in my view. And I don't wish them ill. You know, whatever success you can have, go for it. But I just don't like it. Hi, you.
Hello, sir. out of all 10 seasons of SG-1, what can you remember being your favorite Jack and Sam moment?
Makeout scenes. Do you even ask such a question? Got to be paid to be on set, make it out with a babe like her. She was married, right? those are always fun. And any scenes that I would have with, what's his name? Daniel. Yeah. Were terrific as well. Not for that reason. But because,
you're gonna have to get close to that.
But it was, but he and I developed a really nice rapport, a nice banter rhythm, as with Amanda as well, but God, making out with hooves, just professional, mind you. So not professional. She kept having to say, "No tongue." I said, "No tongue." No, I was saying that to her. Why, do you have another moment in mind?
I was just going to mention at the end of the episode, Window of Opportunity, when you hand in your resignation to kiss her.
What did I do? Hand in my resignation to her?
To General Hammond.
To Hammond.
So you could kiss her.
Oh!
Part of the
yeah, that was, yeah.
Is that pretty
now that I think back, that was a well-written moment. Yeah, you're right. But as a totally lascivious human being, making out was great. Yes, Kitty.
For the Groundhog Day episode, did you learn how to juggle way before the episode, or did you learn just for the episode how to juggle?
I learned how to juggle by, well, like when I moved to California, I had a distant aunt or uncle or something like that that lived in Studio City, California. They had a backyard that had a shack, literally a shack, that they let me like sleep in, live in. And I shared it with a big old box turtle. It was about that day. It was great. I mean, we got along well. Didn't drink. He didn't drink. I don't know. But what was I saying? Where was it? You live with
juggling.
A turtle. Yeah?
Yeah.
Juggling.
Juggling.
Juggling. And I had you going. Anyway, also in this backyard were grapefruit trees and orange trees. And it was a great place to, you know, if you're going to move to California, find somebody with a shack and orange trees in the backyard to live in. I got really healthy, eating all this vitamin C, but I also, you know, learned how to, just by figuring it out and watching, and I also had a buddy that had moved to California a year prior, and he knew how to juggle and just gave me some pointers. The rest is, if I went on, I'd be bored to tears. But it, what happens was that when you're learning, you drop them a lot. So everything that I would drop eventually would split open. I'd have to eat it. Hence, my good health. Thank you.
Hello, Richard.
Sir.
Talking about going back to the concoctions, your MacGyver years, I was wondering, during that time, did they ever come to you and say, Richard, this is how you're going to save the day, this is what you're going to build, this is how you're going to do it, and you thought, yeah, that's never going to
every week. My favorite example of the credibility factor was MacGyver's, some bad guy locks MacGyver into a jail cell. Out in the desert by the airport. Details. And so he locks me in there, and there's no way to get out. What's he going to do? What we had established on the way in, there were some things that you see that we'll come back to, obviously. One of them was a horse tied to the thing, and there was a bicycle, and a bucket of something else. dot, dot, dot. So MacGyver's got to get, you know, somehow get away and do stuff. So what he does, I'll fast forward. takes his belt and probably something else, item of clothing, makes a rope, throws it, and loops, somehow miraculously loops the... See what I mean? Gets the bicycle and drags it close to him, and he starts breaking it down, breaking it apart. And there was a time when we did, I had to do all these voiceovers to explain everything. It was just so insulting, I thought, to the audience, because you can see what I'm doing, but there were some elements in retrospect that did need to be explained. This one, I swear to God, kept me laughing so long. I get the bicycle in and break it down, and the voiceover basically instructs the audience that if the bicycle's made of magnesium...
magnesium bursts.
And if another part of it's made from manganese, by this time I'm going, what are you talking about? No bicycle's not made of
magnesium.
Oh my God. Did anybody see that? Because I was dying. And I had to voice it over with a straight face. So anyway, the idea was to, if it's made out of manganese or whatever, then you could use one of the pipes on the frame and another part of the frame pipe and hit the manganese onto the magnesium, whatever, and create a spark, and out of it you would have a blowtorch. So I can cut through the bars of the jail. That's my favorite episode. Anyway.
I want to thank you for entertaining us over the years. I wanted to ask you, what happens to MacGyver and his son at the end of season 7? Like, where do they go? What happened? Where
yeah, they drive off into the sunset. on our motorcycles, we drove off somewhere, and we disappeared for about 35 years, and then apparently came back with a new series on CBS. And he's lost a step or two like that. Now, we didn't answer that. I haven't really given much thought. You can fantasize whatever you want. That's part of the joy of an imagination.
Woo-hoo! I wanted to ask, was the mullet your idea?
Yes. It happened somewhat accidentally. I had always had long hair. I mean, since the minute the Beatles came out and we hit the States in 64, 5, 3, anyway, started getting, coming over there, I had started having long hair. You know, it was a constant fight with my parents. Well, my mom anyway. My dad was a man of humanities, and my mother was an artist, so I couldn't understand why she wanted me to have a skinhead. But that's what they preferred. So anyway, when I got into junior high school, and the Beatles came out, I let it go. Flash forward, still got long hair, I'm kind of, and we're doing the early stages of MacGyver. And the weeks go by, we're doing more episodes. Guess what? Hair gets longer. It keeps going. But it started to get like this. Like, And so I kept having to fix it. It wouldn't match on camera. So because I keep doing this and it didn't match, we'd have to do it over again, and if it fell. Anyway, so the hairdresser cut the sides off so it wouldn't, you know, I wouldn't have to do that. But the back kept growing, and they didn't see fit to trim it up. Now you go so far with that, it becomes impossible to suddenly chop it off. Because things have to match, and there's a sequence, an evolution to the character and his look and all that business. So it was kind of an accident, and then I just didn't fight anything anymore. Henry Winkler, here's why it was so blonde at times. Henry Winkler came to me, and I'm going to say the word S-H-I-T. Is that okay with you?
Okay. I don't care!
Henry Winkler came to me one point and said, Richard, would you mind if we put some highlights in your hair? And I get some highlights in there, because your hair is so brown, it looks like shit on a stick. For which I thanked him. But they put in some, the same guy that made the accident cutting, made the accident in bleaching, and it was, I swear to God, it looked like Billy Idol for a moment. Anyway, it's obvious that I care a lot about how my hair looks. But that's pretty much the evolution of that. And then, you know, there was Rod Stewart. There was the coach for the Kings at the time. Boy, if anybody knew it in this crowd.
Yeah.
And Barry Melrose, thank you. And then there was MacGyver. That was kind of the springboard for one of the worst designed haircuts ever. I mean, it worked during the 80s, but, you know, we shot into the 90s and beyond. If you see one today, anybody? Any mullets in the crowd? Anybody willing to admit?
Our time is like, we got 20 seconds left here. I'm sorry, we don't have another question, but
what?
We no. don't. There's
what's your question?
There, see? What a nice guy.
I'm just wondering, what inspired you to be in the career that you chose? I mean, it's such a big career choice, and why?
It's an old story. If you've heard it, stop me. But my father was a speech and English teacher and developed a humanities program at a high school in a suburban conference where I live, Roseville, Minnesota. Actually, he was in Columbia Heights. Anyway, he started, he also directed school plays. So as a kid, I'd love to go with him for the rehearsals and you know, the after-school rehearsals. And I'd sit in the audience chairs, what are they called? In the seats, and watch this intriguing behavior on this stage with lights on and people using voices that sound, I mean, it was just a really odd spectacle that fascinated me for some reason. And during one particular scene, and I can't remember the play, but the part of the action was that a birthday cake gets served. Somebody comes out with a birthday cake and the scenes continue. Well, during the rehearsals, this one rehearsal anyway that I was observing, instead of having a cake, a prop cake or something, they brought out a tray full of Hostess Twinkies. Remember how old I am. And the seed was sown that any job I could ever get that would allow me to eat free Twinkies. That's what I want to do.